Okay, good morning, everyone. On this beautiful Sunday morning, my name is Leslie, and I'd like to welcome you to Forest Grove's Sunday morning worship service. A warm welcome to those of you that are here in person and also to those of you who are joining us online. Today's worship leader is Paul Stott. We were lucky enough to have Paul with us back in September. And he provided us that day with a wonderful reflection on the history of the United Church in Canada. So we're looking forward to his second reflection with us today. Paul Stott has been a member of the Trinity St. Paul's Church for over 70 years. After taking early retirement from an accomplished teaching career at Toronto Metropolitan University, which was formerly known as Ryerson, in 2003, he enrolled at Emmanuel College and obtained his master's degree in theology with a focus on hymnology. He served the United Church in volunteer positions for many, many years, including 9 years on the General Council Executive. Would you please join me in welcoming back Paul Stott?
I always wonder when there are sound problems whether God is trying to tell us something, but fortunately we solve them. Let us begin by acknowledging the land that we're worshiping on. For thousands of years, Indigenous people have walked in this land on their own country. Their relationship with the land is at the center of the lives of the Huron people, Wendat people, Anishinaabe people, Haudenosaunee people, and the people of the Mississaugas of the New Credit. They have been forced to learn patience at the hands of our forebears and at our hands. They have been forced to learn patience as they await justice, reconciliation, recognition, land back, the end of a paternalistic colonial mindset that continues to oppress and take away freedom of choice. Now we are the ones learning patience as we wait on all our relations to forgive and decide how and when we will continue together as children of the Creator.
Food celestial feeding.
Let us confess our sins to God. Forgiving God, in a world filled with so much pain, we would rather shut our eyes and be blind than see things as they really are. Grant us the courage to face the reality of our world, and give us the strength to bring your light to those who walk in darkness. Help us see others as you see them, and forgive us when we do not trust you enough to open our eyes to the possibilities before us. Heal our self-inflicted blindness, O God, and lead us in the footsteps of the light of the world, who reveals your glory in his life, his teachings, and his love. In his holy name we pray. Amen. Christ came to lead us in paths of righteousness and to guide us through our lives. Holds us in love and leads us to the place that Christ has prepared for us. Believe in your heart that God loves you and forgives you. Amen.
Our Old Testament reading this morning is from Isaiah chapter 25, verses 1 to 9. When reading the Old Testament, I like to know what is happening. And as Isaiah says these words, he has in his mind what is happening to his people, conquered or in the threat of being conquered by Assyria and the Babylonians. It is a dark time for his people. But as we read, his faith endures. O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name, for you have done wonderful things. Plans formed of old, faithful and sure. If you have made the city a heap, the fortified city a ruin, the palace of foreigners is a city no more, it will never be rebuilt. Therefore, strong peoples will glorify you. Cities of ruthless nations will fear you. For you have been a refuge to the poor, a refuge to the needy in their distress, a shelter from the rainstorm and a shade from the heat. When the blast of the ruthless was like a winter rainstorm, the noise of foreigners like heat in a dry place. You subdued the heat with the shade of clouds. The song of the ruthless was stilled. On the mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, a rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged strained wines. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the covering that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, see, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Testament reading this morning is from Philippians chapter 4, verses 1 to 9. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, my beloved. I urge Euodia and I urge Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you also, my loyal companions, help these women, for they have struggled beside me in the work of the gospel. Together with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to the Lord. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any evidence and there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. As for the things you have learned and received and heard and noticed in me, do them, and the God of peace will be with you.
Our psalm scripture this morning, a metrical version of which we sang earlier, is the 23rd psalm. I'm sure there are many here who could recite this psalm from memory, either the words from the King James Version of the Bible or from the Scottish Psalter, which we sang. Of course, the psalm comes from the Hebrew Bible, so we would be hearing a translation. Since the one is from 1611 and the other from 1650, I have chosen to read a more contemporary translation. I do recognize that the King James translation of the Bible is a masterpiece of Elizabethan literature, and the Scottish Psalter is a treasury of Presbyterian psalmody. But we need to recognize that the knowledge of biblical Hebrew has advanced significantly in the last four centuries. I'm going to read a translation by the contemporary Hebrew scholar Robert Alter. When I read it, you might think that there is not much difference between Alter's translation and those you are more familiar with. Let me just point out a few things that Alter mentions in his notes that are particularly important. First of all, we see the major metaphor, shepherd, sheep, unchanged. The likening of God to a shepherd was a commonplace in the pastoral culture in which the psalm was written. Alter points out that this psalm is justly famous for the affecting simplicity and concreteness with which the metaphor is carried on. While we are used to hearing, "He restoreth my soul," Alter's translation is, "My life he brings back." The Hebrew word is not soul, but life breath. So the image is of someone who has stopped breathing and is revived. With "He leads me in pathways of justice," there is a transition from the shepherd sheep image to the psalmist talking about himself in human terms. Alter's "You moisten my head with oil" is a more literal translation of the Hebrew, which does not contain the verb for anoint. What we hear in this and surrounding verses is a description of the physical elements of a well-lived life: a table laid out with good things to eat, a head of hair rubbed with olive oil, and an overflowing cup of wine. A final difference in Alter's translation is in the last line. Rather than "dwelling in the house of the Lord forever," the translation is "for many long days." This reinforces the phrase "all the days of my life" from the previous verse, since the psalmist is expressing hope for the here and now and not suggesting a condition in the afterlife. In his translation, Alter is attempting an accurate translation of the biblical Hebrew and not attempting to achieve poetic beauty. With that commentary, let's listen to Alter's translation. Our psalm reading, Psalm 23. A David psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. In grass meadows he makes me lie down. By quiet waters guides me. My life he brings back. He leads me on pathways of justice for his name's sake. Though I walk in the vale of death's shadow, I fear no harm, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, it is they that console me. You set out a table before me in the face of my foes. You moisten my head with oil. My cup overflows. Let but goodness and kindness pursue me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord for many long days. These are words that speak directly to our human condition, expressing our faith in a loving and supportive God. As we hear them in this or any other translation, we can understand why this is the best known and best loved of all the Psalms. Let us now look at the Book of Psalms more widely as a collection of worship resources of the Hebrew people. Scholars studying the Psalms classify them into various categories, such as psalms of individual lament, like Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me? Of community lament, like Psalm 44, you have made us like sheep for the slaughter and have scattered us among the nations. Of individual narrative praise, like Psalm 9, I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will tell of all your wonderful deeds. Of community narrative praise, like Psalm 126. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then it was said among the nations, The Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoiced. And psalms of descriptive praise or hymns like Psalm 8. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory among the heavens. Psalm 23 does not fall easily into any single one of these categories, although it has elements of some. It is perhaps best seen as a psalm of trust, and that may account for its enduring popularity. It is a statement of faith, an acceptance of God, with a list of the gifts that God has provided, and which we believe God will continue to provide. The book of Psalms is unique in the Bible. It is a book of liturgies, and it continues to be used as such in both Jewish and Christian worship. The Revised Common Lectionary, which provides suggested scripture readings for each Sunday in a three-year cycle, has a psalm for practically every Sunday. Within the Bible's 150 individual psalms are theological and liturgical content appropriate for almost any worship service. Psalm 23 appears at least once in each of the 3 years of the lectionary cycle. Although we do not know exactly how the Psalms were used in early Jewish worship, we suspect they were either chanted or sung. Sung Psalms have been a feature of Christian worship throughout the ages. In his 2006 book, Lyrical Theology, biblical scholar S.T. Kimbrough Jr. wrote that the Psalms were the epitome of lyrical theology in the Hebrew Bible, an expression of the fullness of human emotion, sorrow, joy, anxiety, conflict, resolve, alienation, reconciliation, despair, hope, determination, and resignation. No wonder there is a psalm appropriate for almost any worship service. In the Church of England prior to the mid-18th century, metrical psalms were the only music sung in church. A similar restriction was present in the Church of Scotland. We thus see psalters in those early years, with the psalms in strophic form, suitable for singing, faithful to the original text. Each stanza had the same number of lines with the same metrical pattern, usually also with a repeated rhyming pattern. Page 747 in Voices United has the metrical version of Psalm 23 from the Scottish Psalter of 1650, set to the well-known tune Crimond, which we sang. It is set in five stanzas of common meter, which is a pattern of 8-6-8-6, where the numbers represent the number of syllables per line. The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to lie. In pastures green he leadeth me, the quiet waters by. So 8-6-8-6. The tune Crimond was written by Jessie Seymour Irvine in 1871. She was the daughter of a parish minister of the Church of Scotland who served in Dunottar, Peterhead, and Crimond in Aberdeenshire. She became an organist in training at the town Banff, and while living in Crimond, she composed a tune for the metrical version of Psalm 23 as an exercise for a composition class. It was first performed at evening worship at Auchterless Parish Church. The other metrical version of the psalm, found in Voices United, begins with the words, "God is my shepherd, I'll not want. I feed in pastures green," and is set to the tune, "Brother James's Air." Composer James Leith Macbeth Bain was born in Scotland around 1840 and was a healer, mystic, and poet known simply as Brother James. Born in a devout Christian home, Bain became doubtful about the faith, but later regained a mystical belief with the aid of the Christo Theosophic Society. As dissenting churches were singing biblical paraphrases and other hymns, the established churches, Church of England, Church of Scotland, slowly came to expand their worship music beyond metrical psalms. Paraphrases of psalms sought to convey the basic meaning of a psalm without maintaining close connection to the biblical text. Our opening hymn this morning, "The King of Love," is a paraphrase of Psalm 23. Metrical psalms feature a close, if not literal, connection with Scripture, while paraphrase psalms allow for textual interpretation and expanded imagery. Paraphrase psalms provided an ideal medium for the noted 18th century hymn writer Isaac Watts to interpret the Psalms in the context of the New Testament covenant. His stated aim was to make David sing like Christ, like a Christian. His greatest work, the 1719 hymn book, with the rather ponderous title, "The Psalms of David Imitated in the Language of the New Testament and Applied to the Christian State and Worship," contained the paraphrase of Psalm 23 entitled, "My Shepherd Shall Supply My Need." In the last stanza, we hear a reflection of Jesus' call to suffer the little children. Watt's text is usually set to the tune, "Resignation."
My shepherd will supply. Side.
I find the simile in the final stanza of this paraphrase immensely powerful. Watts has chosen to describe what living in God's house means to him. He is not there as a stranger or a guest, but the simple comfort and security of a child at home. The Bible provides us with a rich treasure of liturgical resources in the Book of Psalms. We can and do read them, chant them, and sing them in our worship and private devotions. Over and above the scriptural texts in many translations, we have metrical settings and paraphrases written over many centuries that expand on these texts and reset them in differing contexts. They describe and allow us to express the widest possible range of human situations and emotions as we speak to God in worship. Of all the 150 Psalms, the one that is best known and loved most widely is Psalm 23. A hymn of trust, it is an expression of biblical faith in God and our trust in God to provide for us in good times and bad throughout our lives. Thanks be to God.
It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside. I'm not one of those who can easily hide. Don't have that much money, but boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live. Sculptor, but then again, no, or man who makes potions in a traveling show. No, it's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift is my song, yeah, this one's for you. Song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in words how wonderful life is while you're in the verses, well, they've got me quite cross, but the sun's been quite kind while I wrote this song. It's for people like you and I, keep it turned on. Excuse me for getting, but these things I do. Forgotten if they're green or they're blue. Anyway, the thing is, what I really mean is yours are the sweetest eyes I've ever seen. And you can tell everybody that this is your song. But now that it's done, I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in words how wonderful life is while you're in the world.
As we journey from this place, remember that we go with the fellowship and support of God, the source of love, Jesus Christ, love incarnate, and the Holy Spirit, love's power.